Pain, we almost you wanting to hear Vinay say, so I can't even introduce him.
It's really good to be among friends, and so many friends. I'm very grateful to all of you for having come here. And I'm also very grateful to Tushar and his fellow artists. We went there. I think Irina has already described the way in which we were able to feel what we had been intellectually apprehending for so long. But to feel, to give it that kind of effect, which we encountered during our visit there today, to see all these art, you know, exhibits there today, I think it really gave us a whole new dimension on what we had been perceiving in different ways till today. So I'm very grateful. I thank all of you for the kind of work that you have done. I don't think there's much point in my talking about sedition after so many people have talked about it already. So I won't make the mistake of doing that. And you're all waiting to see the Dastan Goy also, so I'll try to make my presentation as short as I can.
Yeah, 10 minutes at least.
But I'd like to tell you, I think when Irina was ending, she said that, Jyoti also reinforced that, that what is it that makes the government contemptible? And that is something that I'd really like to just, the kind of problem of hunger in society today, in India today. This is something that I've been talking about a lot. And for quite a long time, I've talked about it as this. If you people have heard this argument before, then just please bear with me, because I'd like to talk about it again. India is living in a situation in which half the population is living in a state of chronic famine. If this sounds like exaggeration, or this sounds like dramatization, it's not true. I'll give you the figures based on government statistics to bear this out. The National Institute of Nutrition in Hyderabad has a section of it called the National Nutrition Monitoring Bureau. The National Nutrition Monitoring Bureau, its entire responsibility is to some people like to come inside because they think there's a lot of crowd at the door. So can more people come in?
We'll sit here in the middle aisle.
Yeah, so the National Nutrition Monitoring Bureau carries out serial surveys of nutritional status. One of the measures they use is called Body Mass Index. I just want to tell you a little bit about Body Mass Index because I think everybody should know about Body Mass Index, and it helps you to understand the problem of hunger in society today. Body Mass Index is weight in kilograms divided by height in meters squared. My weight in kilograms is 80 kilos. My height is 1.75 meters. So 80 divided by 1.75 squared is my body mass index, which is uncomfortably towards more than it should be. But I am talking about the lower end of the scale, 18.5. If the body mass index is below 18.5, then that is indicative of chronic undernutrition. And the statistics show that 37% of the entire adult population of India has a body mass index below 18.5. I'm sure nobody in this hall has a body mass index of below 18.5. So it tells you a little bit about where this statistic is coming from. So or 37% of the entire adult population has a body mass index below 18.5. If we disaggregate that a little bit, children, you can't measure the body and mass index because they're still growing. It's only adults who can measure the body mass index. Children, 47% of our children below 5 years are malnourished by weight for age criteria. We have standardized tables of weight and age, correlating weight and age. And by those standardized tables, our 47% of our children are malnourished by weight for age criteria. Coming to adults, 37% of our entire adult population, men and women, have a body mass index below 18.5. If we disaggregate that, we find that 50% of the scheduled tribes have a body mass index below 18.5. 60% of the scheduled castes have a body mass index below 18.5. Among the minority communities, if you look at the Satchar Committee report and the data presented by Abu Saleh Sharif, as part of the Satchar Committee report, large sections of the minority communities have a body mass index below 18.5. Now this means that there are significant sections of the Indian population who are chronically suffering from chronic undernutrition. WHO says that any community which has more than 40% of its members with a body mass index below 18.5 should be considered a community in famine. This shows that there are significantly large sections of the Indian population who can be considered to be in a state of famine. Chronically considered to be in a state of famine, and in fact the entire population of India is perilously close to that 40% criterion which the WHO is saying demarcates the state of famine from the state of adequacy. So we have here a situation where there are large sections of the Indian population, and in fact practically the whole of the adult Indian population, living in a state of famine today. Now, it is exactly these same populations which are being, these populations are able to survive only because they have access to common property resources. They live in close communion with the land, water, forest, biodiversity, seed, and these are exactly the resources that are being snatched away from them. And the Indian state today is a guarantor for this process of expropriation. And we are at a time in history, we are living at a time in history when for the first time, this has never happened before. It has always been the function of the state to take things away from the poor. But we have never been told that this is a legitimate process. Today, after the onset of globalization, we are being told that this is a legitimate way for the government to develop the economy. That taking things away from the poor and handing it over to the rich with the state standing as guarantor, this is the legitimate function of state. Directive principles of state policy say that all state action must be directed at reducing inequity, at reducing inequity, at promoting equity. And today we have a situation in India where the whole predominant tendency of state policy is to promote inequity by handing resources over to private economic interests. Now, this is a situation which under the United Nations, under the aegis of the United Nations, there is a protocol for the prevention of the crime of genocide, which tells us that genocide doesn't happen only by killing people. It's not that genocide is only about shooting people with bullets. 2C of the Convention for the Prevention of the Crime of Genocide tells us that the creation of conditions in which the survival of communities is put at risk is also a form of genocide. Today, where there are communities living in famine, who are surviving because of access to common property resources, and their access to common property resources is deliberately being put on under question. And in this situation, no alternative measures for their survival are instituted. Hirakud Dam, 50 years ago, and we still haven't finished with the rehabilitation. The Narmada, we all know what is happening in the, with the rehabilitation process, despite this strong and committed people's movement, we still haven't been able to secure relief and rehabilitation for all the displaced people. So in this situation, we are in a situation where the Indian state is perilously close. I won't commit sedition and say it has actually reached that state, but it is perilously close to committing the crime of genocide. This is not something new. Mahatma Gandhi was asked his opinion of Western civilization, he said it would be a good idea. So the Americans have finished off the Red Indians in the North American continent. At the time when Columbus discovered, within quotation marks, America, the population of North America and the population of Europe were almost equal. Today we can see the difference. Similarly, in South America, in Australia, we know what happened to the indigenous populations. Today, because the Indian elites do not have an external source which they can exploit for their own development, so we look inwards, and this is the situation that will result. So we are perilously close to repeating the same stories that have been thrust on us, on other indigenous populations in the past. We are a nation. I am proud of being an Indian. Anybody, despite what the government may tell you, I am proud to be an Indian. I am proud of our culture. And what is it that distinguishes our culture? I think what distinguishes our culture is our ability to be together, to bridge over differences. We have the highest amount of diversity in the world. There is no other nation in the world that has this much diversity as Indians have, as India has. We are able to live with that kind of diversity among ourselves. We must be proud of this heritage. We must promote this heritage. And we have, and this, instead of eating up our own indigenous populations, we should be able to all live together and prosper together. I think this is what our heritage demands from us. And I think that's, I'll finish there. And thank you very much for listening to me. And
thank you. I think after listening to Binayak Sen, there's no way we cannot be seditious. I don't mean it as a joke. We should actually resolve that we should be as seditious as possible, which means we should really expose the government for what it is. If any of us know something which others don't know about the way the government treats its own people, we should bring it out however we can. And the more we do it, I'm sure the government will finally have to repeal this law one day.
I'm sorry, there's something I meant to say which I forgot to say. There is, from the People's Union for Civil Liberties, PUCL, we are running the right to food case, and a lot of interlocutory orders have come from the Supreme Court in the right to food case. Now, we have been, the right to food movement has campaigned for right to food, has been demanding that there should be universal public distribution system. That means that this whole targeted public distribution system has to come to a stop, because a lot of people fall through the holes in the net. Okay? and the BPL, this whole BPL, ABL business has to be brought to an end, and everybody should be eligible for subsidized rations. I'm sure you won't find Mukesh Ambani standing in line to collect his ration. So whoever needs it will be able to access the rations that are available. That's one. Secondly, 35 kilos per family per month, that's just inadequate. It only lasts for 15 to 17 days, and after that, people have to buy the grain at the same extortionate rates, which they cannot afford. So we want a supply of subsidized grain that will be adequate to last the month. And thirdly, just grain is not enough. We need other things other than grain to be stay healthy. So if we are proud of our public distribution system, it must also contain other food apart from grain, like dal and oil, which also need to be supplied at subsidized rates. That's one thing that I wanted to talk about. And the other thing I wanted to talk about is about sedition. Because the PUCL has just held a consultation in Delhi, and to which we invited representatives of other human rights organizations, and many people came from all across the country. And we had a two-day consultation, at the end of which we decided to oppose sedition laws and our campaign for the repeal of all sedition laws. And we are going to go on a campaign to collect 1 million signatures from across the nation and present these signatures to the winter session of parliament, asking for repeal of law 124A and all other sedition related sedition provisions in other laws like UAPA and so on and so forth. So for these, both these proposals, I would like to have your support, and especially for the signature campaign, I intend to come back and come to all of you, and I hope that we will be able to have a large number of signatures from Bombay. Thank you very much.
Will this meeting pass a resolution asking for repeal of sedition law?
Yeah.
We should.
I guess so.
Why didn't you ask the supposed
questions?
Any questions
from
the audience, please?
Sir, regarding these.
Like to dissent means lack of consent of the public. When there is no forum for the common man to represent his views, or when does sedition begin is the right question. What makes a character of person from the public to obliterate the authority domination of the government? Why does the government pass licenses, approvals, contracts which are against the people? Why don't they take the consent when the president of the parliament gives a candidate and the people have to stand for the elected representative to come to parliament or the legislature? Why shouldn't they take the people who elect the representative and have a whole time voting and discussion on this? Why these are not taken into consideration?
I think my friend is expressing his outrage rather than asking a question, so I won't try to answer.
The right to dissent, one could justify the right to dissent into an armed dissent, because there comes a point, I suppose, when the weak and vulnerable have no other recourse. What is your view?
Actually, I was hoping I wouldn't be asked that question. See, as human rights workers, we uphold the Constitution of India. The Constitution of India envisages a democratic polity. And as my friend there said, the democratic polity is not limited to the exercise of elections once in every 5 years. Democracy is about governance through consent, or it means nothing else. So we have to have governance by consent. Now, as far as the question of when is it legitimate for dissent to take an armed expression, our feeling, my feeling, I can't speak for anyone else, my feeling is that violence doesn't solve any problems. Violence doesn't solve problems. But at the same time, the state seeks to have a monopoly on the use of violence. Now this is again, I think Mahatma Gandhi had opposed this provision of state, these you know, provisions of state policy at the time of independence. In any case, we do not agree that the state has a legitimate monopoly of violence. Either if the state wants the movement, you know, dissent to be non-violent, then it has an also, it also has an obligation to be non-violent itself. It cannot deploy violence and then ask the, you know, the people who are oppressed that you limit your dissent to you know, to non-violent expression. That's one. But apart from that, the second point that I wanted to make was that survive. See, where communities are not able to survive, where the survival of communities is being put into question, where communities are in danger of becoming, you know, of their own extinction, then I think that I will not try to answer the question, but I will ask the question on behalf of these communities, that what does the overall Indian polity, what advice does the Indian polity have to give to these people whose survival is under question and whose extinction is becomes a real possibility? In that case, where genocide becomes a real possibility, the genocide under Section 2C of the Convention for the Prevention of the Crime of Genocide, under those situations, what advice does the Indian polity have to offer to these communities? That this is the question that I would like to ask. Thank you.
I just wanted to express solidarity with Vinay Sen and the campaign which is being organized here, the Right to Dissent. We are also involved with the campaign for removal of political prisoners in Maharashtra. So, I mean, it really is important for people to participate in this meeting and campaign. Raise issues like in 2007, after the arrest of Vinay Sen, we had the arrest of someone like Arun Ferreira from Bombay, who was arrested from Nagpur. Subsequent to that, we had just the beginning of this year, the arrest of Sudhir Dhawale, who was an activist with the Dalit organization, who has been arrested under sedition. We just recently, we are in the middle of arranging for the for legal aid for Anjala Solkarke, who is an extremely educated person and who was brought to the Mazgaon court wearing, you know, these masks as though there's some kind of terrorist. So this kind of situation, which Dr. Vinay Sen has undergone and come out of, we see so many such cases happening around us. You know, just 2 weeks ago, we read about construction laborers from Pune being arrested as Maoists. For what? This is a campaign of Rakesh Maria to make out as though there is some golden corridor in Bombay, Surat, and Pune, and you know, this kind of a terror atmosphere, with which it becomes impossible to reach out legally you know, in the kind of atmosphere in Pune today, it is impossible for lawyers to and provide legal aid for these laborers. I mean, they have come from West Bengal. They are working as construction laborers, and we are working, we are trying to find some way in which legal aid can be issued. So therefore, this aspect of this campaign, that there are hundreds of people locked up, you know, in some way in which we can, you know, like this, as it's happening in Kathimpur, it's happening in Gachiroli. There are hundreds of tribals who are locked up with absolutely no knowledge of what other section they have been put under. Right now in Nagpur High Court is a case which has been filed about one tribal, Vishwanath Kulmate, against whom the police, Nagpur police, have put 40 cases. When he is acquitted in all of them, the day of his release, he is put in another set of cases. So, I mean, it goes on and on and on. So this kind of, you know, situation that exists, I think everyone got inspired when Vinayak Sen was released and he said that, you know, you have to campaign for prisoners whom he has seen inside the jail and whom we know are their home or over the country. They're not just the tribal, they are Muslims, they are, you know, the minorities, the deprived section. So the laws like sedition laws, UAPA, these are basically used to suppress the right to organize, the right to dissent. So we have to also find ways in which to campaign at that level.
I would like to know, because I read somewhere, you mentioned just to use between poverty and deprivation. And you said about deprivation, this is directly related to this policy on the law, if I understood. So how do you think, because you are talking about iniquity, this policy has brought real iniquity. And what Joseph Stiglitz said, that defined development as growth plus equity. So element of equity is very much lacking. Government is hell-bent to brought this sort of policy, because they have to show that GDP and all sorts of things. So where the hope lies, according to you? What is the payoff?
Lines from T.S. Eliot: I am no prophet, nor was meant to be. I am an attendant lord, one that will do to swell a progress, start a scene, advise the prince. So this is this apart. But the point, I don't have answers to all these questions. I can only raise questions. I can't answer them because, not because I'm an ignoramus and don't know much, but because it's only the people, the organized strength of the people expressing itself through political action that can answer these questions. The principles everybody knows, but it's only when the political action takes place that the questions will be answered. So this is my answer to that question. Thank you.
I was just wondering that if these laws are repealed, would the people who have been put away, would they automatically get acquitted, or how does it work?
It will depend on whether it's prospective effect or retrospective effect.
No, but
from now onwards it won't be applied. But what happened about the case is gone.
No, but bail will be easier. Bail will be possible. Bail is not possible.
Bail may be easier.
But
the cases which are pending, then that has to have a different kind of order, and not people are still in.
Yeah. What about the news that you are going to be called by the Lady Commission? What is that? What is the call of it?
How can we answer? Can we continue the discussion later? Because
yeah, we have asking whether we talked about passing a resolution.
Yeah, passing a resolution, yes.
This meeting resolves to campaign for the repeal of the right of the
sedition laws, but you have to ask
also other undemocratic
unlawful activities prevention
Can we ask Sanobar to draft this?
Yeah.